So once again, you are here for the U.S. Laws and CO Knowledge Exchange, which is going to be hosted by CORE. So who is leading this call today? My name is Ella Fowler. I'm the Senior Program Officer for Learning Engagement here at CORE. I've been with CORE for a little over 4 years now, and I'm joined by two other CORE staff, Amy Franz. She'll have a wave there in the video. She's our senior training coordinator for CORE, and she's going to be helping out in the breakout rooms and with technology and in the chat. If you're having any issues today with technology, please go ahead and let Amy know in the chat, and she's available to help you. I'm also joined by my colleague, Phillips, our curriculum design officer, who's also going to be helping in the breakout rooms, and she just gave you a wave there on our camera. She's going to be in the breakout rooms helping to lead our discussion today. And then we're also joined by two guest facilitators. We have Dennis Umna. I don't know if I said that right, Dennis. And Dennis can turn on his camera and give a wave, as well as Stephanie Bonilla. They're both from the RSC in Latin America, and they will be helping us in the breakout rooms. However, they also supported us in preparing for this webinar. So just a huge shout out to RSC Latin America and RSC Africa, who helped us put this webinar together and just supported us in coming up with the content. So a huge shout out to them, and thank you both for being here today and helping us facilitate this webinar. So just a few reminders. As if you've never joined a CORE webinar before, welcome. We're really glad to have you here. If you have been in a CORE webinar before, you know that we are very interactive. So this webinar is only going to be successful if you participate and you are present. So please take a moment, close out of your Microsoft Outlook, close out of your Teams, Google, Slack, whatever you use to communicate, and be present with us here for this full 90 minutes today. We will be going into breakout rooms, which will require your participation and engagement. So please respect everyone's time and be here and be present today. We will share the recording and the materials within 1 week. There is a holiday in the US this weekend, so you will see an email sometime next week with us with the materials and the recording. And I just want to flag that this is a 90-minute exchange. We will have a 5-minute break about halfway through, so you can get up and you can stretch, but it is 90 minutes instead of 60 minutes today. I also just want to share that closed captioning is enabled if you want to turn that on the bottom of your screen. I also want to share that I have a tendency to talk fast. It's my kryptonite. So if I'm talking too fast, please go ahead and let me know in the chat so that I know to slow down so that you can understand me. Welcome, Carolyn Bush. We're so glad to have you here. No worries on being late. All right. We do have a lot. Oh, sorry. We are going to be using this new feature in Zoom called the Zoom chat reply feature. And so because we're going to be using this throughout today's webinar, we want to take a moment and practice this. So on the screen, you're going to see the instructions of how to do this. And Amy's going to go ahead and put a message in the chat. And it says, reply to this message. What do you know about the CO topic of U.S. laws? And go ahead and follow the instructions on the screen to reply to this message. Now, if you do not have the ability to reply, it's because your Zoom has not been updated. And if that's the case for you, you can go ahead and just send a regular message. But as much as possible to help us maintain chat, we want to get folks to be able to apply directly to the message. All right, so I'm seeing some folks coming in. There are a few of you who are saying that you don't know much about the cultural orientation topic of U.S. laws. And when we say the cultural orientation topic of U.S. laws, we mean, what do you know about the objectives and indicators for the topic of U.S. laws? So if folks are still learning, no idea, to be honest, that's okay, Huda. We're happy you're here. It can be based on where you live. It's one of the topics for fiscal year 2024. So still learning. Great. Well, we're really happy to have you guys here. We hope that you will learn quite a bit of information. For those of you who are new and maybe haven't heard about cultural orientation, objectives and indicators, or that term before, there might be some concepts today that are harder for you to understand. But we do encourage you to go back and review the pre-session kind of homework that we asked you to look at, the COONI webpage and the micro-learning video. after this session if any of the terms today are new to you or you don't understand. We do have a lot to kind of get through. And so if you have a question, go ahead and share those questions in the chat. If Amy and I don't respond to you, do know that we will be going through the chat and we will follow up on any questions outside of the space if we're not able to get to it during the webinar. All righty. So our objectives today are as follows. We really want you guys to understand what refugees are expected to do or say with U.S. laws by the end of CO. So we're going to take a look at the cultural orientation objectives and indicators, because that is what we are expected to cover in cultural orientation programming. And then anything that are outside of those CO ONIs, you know, that can be covered in other touch points or outside of the RMP programming. So really understanding what is in the CO ONI for U.S. laws. And then we're going to work to identify techniques to address the challenges that arise when we deliver this topic. And so when we say challenges, we mean addressing sensitive topics, staying on the COONI, so managing and balancing time, managing expectations of refugees. And then we really hope to help you guys exchange with other CO providers on how to improve the CO delivery across the CO continuum. So those are our objectives today, and we really hope that we are able to achieve those. So let's go ahead and delve into an overview of U.S. laws. So like I said, this is looking specifically at the cultural orientation topic of U.S. laws. So we are going to go ahead and launch a poll. Amy, are you able to launch the poll?
Yep, awesome. I can. Thanks
so much. So the poll has been launched, and we want you to answer, U.S. laws has always been an overseas CO topic, true or false?
Now, I just say that Thursday participants are much more active than Tuesday participants.
Hey, 8 a.m. versus 2. There's a big difference. All right. So it looks like 100, we have still about 10 people who haven't participated, but we're going to go ahead and end the poll, and I'm going to share results because this is actually pretty interesting. 50-50. So some of you think that U.S. laws has always been an overseas CO topic, and some of you are saying false, that it's not always been an overseas topic. The answer to this question is false. U.S. laws was added to the overseas cultural orientation objectives and indicators as part of the revised COONI process. Previously, U.S. laws was not required to be covered in overseas CO. It wasn't one of the topics. It did come up in other ways. And so when the PRM and the CO working group went to revise the COONIs and strengthen the CO continuum, they felt that U.S. laws was needed in overseas CO to at least begin the conversation around what U.S. law will be like in the U.S. So I'm going to share in the chat for those of you who are like, what are you talking about, revised COONIs, and what are these changes? There's a summary of changes to the COONIs that CORE has available on our website, and Amy just put that into the chat for you if you want to go take a look and read about how the COONIs were revised. We also did some training earlier this year, and you can access those on our CO provider YouTube channel. So on the screen here, I have the cultural orientation objectives and indicators for U.S. laws. And as you can see here, there are three objectives. Participants can explain that the U.S. is governed by the rule of law. Participants can explain their responsibility to know and follow the law. And participants can articulate there are legal rights and responsibilities related to family life in the United States. And as you can see, these objectives are the same overseas and domestically. What's different is the indicators that are required to be covered. So we've gone ahead and we've put here stars next to the indicators that are covered overseas. And then the ones that don't have stars are the indicators that are covered domestically. So you have to cover all of the indicators domestically, whereas overseas, they're only covering the first four. So I already covered that. It's really important for everyone working in resettlement to be aware of both sets of the cultural orientation objectives and indicators. If you're overseas, this really helps you see how the information you introduce overseas will be built upon when the individual arrives into the U.S. And knowing and looking at all of the domestic COO&Is is really important, because as part of the revised COO&I process, some indicators that were under U.S. laws domestically have been moved to safety. And so it's really important if you work overseas to review the domestic COO&Is, all of them, so that you can see, all right, when they get to the United States, there will be discussions on how to be safe in the U.S., how to interact with police, how to be safe in your home. And if those questions come up in overseas CO, I can manage what's relevant by knowing what's going to be covered domestically. Then for domestic providers, it's really important to review the overseas COO&Is to help you see how much that has been covered and what information refugees may already know when they arrive in the United States. It also helps us maintain consistent messaging about life in the U.S. So when we're all using the COO&Is, we really create a strong continuum of messaging from pre-departure to post-arrival about life in the U.S. and about U.S. law. So I want to go ahead and take a moment to ask you all, what challenges do you have when you deliver the topic of CO of the topic of U.S. law? So in the chat, Amy's going to put this question, and we want you all to use the Zoom reply feature that we went over earlier and share what are the challenges you have when you deliver the CO topic of U.S. law. Broad. Yeah, Logan, there is a lot to cover, and that's why it's really important to ground yourself in this, what's in the CO objectives and indicators, and help prioritize, this is what I need to cover in CO programming, and these are questions I often get, and they're not in the O&I, so how can I cover those in other touch points, or how can I cover those outside of reception and placement? U.S. laws is a very, very broad topic, right? There's a lot that we can cover. But the reason we have the COO&Is is to help us focus our attention on these three objectives and these indicators first, so that we can really make sure refugees get the information that they need. So getting state-specific questions about laws, absolutely. And I'm assuming that you are overseas, this person. And so that's definitely really hard if you're overseas and you're getting state-specific questions because you don't know where folks are going. So managing that, I'm sure, can be pretty difficult. There isn't enough time, comprehension, understanding the differences. So I am seeing that we're kind of getting out of using the Zoom reply feature, which is okay, but just want to flag that we really would like you all to try to reply to the statements themselves to help us manage the chat. But I do appreciate folks' response here. Yeah, example, talking about sexual harassment and abuse is hard to share with some clients because of the culture. Absolutely. There's a lot of conversations that you have to have that are very challenging, and that's what we hope to work with you today. And how can we identify some techniques so that you can manage the session and manage your classroom and still maintain a positive learning environment and a positive experience for refugees where you and they feel like they're getting what they need to be able to be successful? And that can be a difficult balance to strike. The reason I wanted to have you guys share what challenges you have is to really emphasize that we are all facing similar challenges when we're delivering the topic of U.S. laws. And so by just sharing this information, we can really validate our experience and remind us that we are addressing some of the same challenges together. It also reminds us that some of these challenges we're not going to be able to completely get rid of in CO. But there are ways that we can reduce and mitigate the risks of these challenges taking over CO sessions. So that's okay, Jean. Thank you for attending today. So one of the things we did in the registration was ask you to submit the questions and comments that you really get when you are delivering the topic of U.S. law. And so we went ahead and categorized these questions into overseas and domestic. So we want you to go ahead and take a moment to review these questions. And when you're done reviewing them, go ahead and write done in the chat box. So most of the questions that you see on this list are based on anxiety and fear or stress about adjusting to a new country and laws. So our role as CO providers and individuals in resettlement is to really support refugees in learning about life in the U.S. and building necessary tools and skills to help refugees advocate for themselves and their families. CO providers cannot address all the specific questions refugees have about their case or specific questions about U.S. laws. Instead, we need to build our skills to manage refugees' questions and balance managing expectations with the reality of the resettlement process. For example, for refugees overseas, everything about the U.S. is going to seem relevant to them. From navigating citizenship to employment to the education system, refugees want to know everything they can about the U.S. and how it applies to them. But overseas CO is not able to do that. They are not case managers, and the information known at that time is often very limited. Instead, overseas CO providers need to manage refugees' expectations and help refugees realize what is going to be relevant to them when they arrive in the U.S. And so what this might look like is managing what is relevant in CO and what isn't relevant in CO. Managing expectations and other techniques CO providers need to use take time to build. So through our discussions today, our goal is to really identify techniques and strategies you can employ to respond to some of these questions while still staying on topic of what is outlined in the CO objectives and indicators, balancing time and managing difficult learners. As you deliver CO and build your skills as a CO provider, you may begin to identify themes and questions or how you might respond to specific questions. And so what we have done is we're going to share in the chat a link to a what is called a common questions list. It's the CO curriculum common questions. And this is a really great resource for you to adapt and use to help you keep track of the types of questions that you're getting at your agency and how you might be able to respond to those questions. This can be used as a parking lot tool or template to document questions that are outside of CO and just really help you identify what are some of the themes that you are getting and how can you manage the messaging around some of the questions that you get. So we are doing really, really well on time right now. And so I want to take a moment and just see if folks have some thoughts or questions on either the challenges that you have, questions that you get, or what is covered in U.S. laws, in the topic of U.S. laws. You're very welcome, Logan. I'll take this moment while you all are thinking about that question to plug our September 20th webinar on the Road Ahead curriculum, where we'll be looking at that resource as well as the Road Ahead curriculum, and there'll be more great resources like that. For overseas CO, where can I find the answers to these questions? So I'm sorry, I don't know how to say your name, but we're going to talk about that as we go through today in our breakout rooms. I want to stress that you should actually not put pressure on yourself to know the answer to all of these questions. Because if you look at the cultural orientation objectives and indicators, some of these questions are not related to the topic that you're trying to teach. And so we really want to focus. We have the objectives and indicators to help us know and keep us focused on what we need to cover in CO and what's relevant. So if you're overseas and you're getting a lot of questions that are on topics that aren't in the CO ONI, you shouldn't go out and try to find answers to every single one of those questions, because that's going to take away from your cultural orientation delivery. Instead, what you need to do is you need to find ways to manage expectations of refugees and find ways to let them know that when they arrive in the United States, they're going to continue their learning and they're going to continue to have opportunities to ask ongoing questions throughout the process. You're very welcome. I'm going to scroll back up because I feel like there was a lot happening in the chat that maybe I didn't see before. And so, Rachel, I saw that you put this question about miscategorization on most U.S. forms. That's a really interesting question that I think a lot of people will get. But again, that's not necessarily something that should be covered in cultural orientation. And I think that's a really, when we're thinking about cultural orientation and the topic of U.S. laws for this webinar, we're thinking about when you're actually delivering a CO session on U.S. laws and not necessarily when you're meeting one-on-one with an individual and they're asking questions about U.S. laws. Yep, so the link is just to a PDF there, Jacqueline. All right, well, I'm not getting a lot of thoughts, and so this will give us more time in our breakout rooms, which I'm happy to do. I would rather spend more time in breakout rooms and talking about some of these challenges and applying techniques. Before we do that, though, I do just want to, I'm going to leave this COO and I up on your screen while we go into a 5-minute break, because I really want to make sure that we are all grounded in what is covered in the cultural orientation objectives and indicators versus what questions that we might get that are outside of these indicators. And we're going to talk about that more in our breakout room. But I'm going to leave this up on the screen while we take a 5-minute break. So I will go ahead and put a timer on there. And this 5-minute break is just to get you up and moving and kind of digesting the information we just shared. And then we'll come back and we're going to go into breakout rooms. So please come back at 30 minutes past the hour. All right. Ding, 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 ding. Thank you so much for being on camera, Kristen. And I wish I could, is it Aika? 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 Thank you so much for being on camera.
Aicha.
Thank you. All right. So there were some things that were came up in the chat that I just want to flag for folks. So I do just want, someone asked if we get points, if there's points for joining or credit for joining this webinar. There are not any points or credits. CORE doesn't offer any sort of credits for our webinars. And then somebody else asked in the chat or expressed in the chat that it's, since you aren't experts in laws, it is beneficial to bring in outside experts, and that's absolutely true. And partnering with guests is a really great idea. But also being mindful of, you know, what can you cover in CO sessions versus maybe what might be better covered outside of CO sessions. So when you're working with a guest partner, it's really great to make sure you cover and have them know what's in the CO O&I. And then if there's a lot of questions that they're getting that are outside of the CO O&I, maybe having an optional session that clients can come to learn more. And you can make sure to balance, you know, make covering what is required in CO programming and the objectives and indicators, and then using another space to provide more learning and more information so that you are making sure that you cover what is required in CO programming. So really love the idea. I'm gonna ask Amy to share in the chat for us CORE's promising practice on how to include guests from the community. So we are gonna be going into breakouts. Really quickly for my breakout room facilitators, we are gonna go 10 past the hour. So whenever you guys get in there, you're gonna go to 2:10, and then we'll come back and debrief for 20 minutes. But for everyone else, we are gonna put you all into breakout rooms. And we are gonna be placing you in breakout rooms with individuals from across the globe. So you will be in a breakout room with other individuals who are overseas and domestic. You're going to be in a breakout room with a facilitator that you saw earlier in the introduction. Like we said, each breakout room is going to address a challenge that often arises when delivering the topic of U.S. laws. And each room will have a scenario to discuss, and you'll explore that challenge. You're going to actually have closer to 40 minutes than 30 minutes. You are all encouraged to take your own notes, and you'll be asked to share out in a group debrief in the chat. Your facilitator is also going to bring back 3 takeaways and techniques that they heard from the group to share out, but we do want to hear from you all. And so do take notes as we're going through. So the breakout rooms that we're going to have today is group one is going to be discussing the topic of staying on topic. So when we are getting a lot of questions in a CO session on U.S. laws, how do we stay on the topic of the CO objectives and indicators? And what are some techniques that we can employ to manage when topics go awry? Group two is going to talk about expectations about U.S. laws. So how do we manage the challenge of why do I have to do this when I'm in the U.S.? Why can't I drive if I don't have a driver's license? Why does my wife have to work? Why? So that's what that group is going to really discuss. Group three is going to address the topic of the role of the police, because there's a lot of challenges that can come up with that topic, and how can we address that topic. And then group four is going to talk about changing family dynamics, which is also a topic that comes up quite a bit, and there are challenges that can come up around that. So I want to reemphasize that our goal today is to identify a variety of strategies and techniques to respond to these difficult conversations. And the skills and confidence to manage these conversations are going to build over time. So our goal today is to have you walk away with some techniques, but you might not necessarily have all of the confidence to really apply them in your work, but you'll have some in your portfolio that you can begin to apply. So any questions before we go ahead and send you into your breakout rooms? All right, folks, Amy is going to go ahead and we're going to launch the breakout room. And so you're going to see on your screen a join button, and you're going to go ahead and click that join button. So I turn it over to you, Amy, to get to launch the breakout room.
Hello, good morning, good afternoon. If you are willing, please go ahead and turn on your camera. Feel free to open your microphone in just a minute so that we can join together and have this conversation. Our breakout room is going to be talking about how to keep participants on topic. So some of the strategies that we use overseas and domestically when participants ask too many questions, everything is kind of overwhelming or very high tension. What do we do to bring the participants back, to calm the CO session, and still provide comfort, provide expertise and guidance? So we do have a short video that we are going to watch, and then we're going to use that video for conversation. Any questions for me before we start? I see a few people, Mohammed, Samir, Nalucha. Great to see your faces. I'm happy to see you. Anyone else that wants to have your camera on, we would love to have you join. I'm going to start sharing my screen, but please do open your microphone and ask a question if you do have a quick question for me. So again, our focus is going to be this idea of staying on topic. How do we keep participants on topic when participants ask too many questions, the applicants or the clients just keep asking questions? How do we bring them back? Always wanting to be managing expectations and focusing on what the refugee can control. Right? You can control your own behavior, you can control your own expectations, but you can't control, you know, what the neighbor is going to be doing. We are going to watch a short video showing like a mock CO session. This video is myself and some of our other core staff. Please don't judge us. We are not actors and actresses. We are just trying to give a good conversation starting for us. So in this video, we are giving a CO session about US laws. We have watched a video about rights and responsibilities. I, as the CO provider, I ask the participants, how are the laws in your home country different from the laws in the United States? And you will see the participants become very agitated, become very upset. And we're trying to think of how can, what can we do to bring the participants back to the conversation? Let me just start, and then if you can give me a thumbs up, Mohammed or Naluchas, if you can hear my sound.
Now that we've watched this video about...
Can you hear my sound there with when I start that?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, yes. Thank you so much. Let me start us over here.
Now that we've watched this video about the rights and responsibilities, how are the laws in your home country different from the laws in the US?
I
I saw in the news and I heard from my family that immigrants aren't wanted in the United States, and I'm very concerned and scared. I want to know how my family and I will be safe there.
You know, that's a really good question,
yeah,
too.
I actually heard the same thing. I recently saw on Facebook there was an article about how this immigrant family had their home vandalized, and then their kids were told to go back to their country and school.
So I want you to
Wait,
know
wait,
that.
my kids won't be safe at school? They've already been through so much.
So I would like
Wait, I
to.
haven't heard this before. Is the US even safe for me and my family?
So my first question for you is, the participants are getting so upset and continuing to build off of each other. What should the CO provider do? Or what would you do in this situation in your CO session? I don't have the ability to put the poll on the screen, so feel free to open your microphone and answer or type in our chat to answer. What would you say the provider should do next? We have some options here. Nothing. Let the participants express themselves. Let the participants share their concerns. Acknowledge the concerns to lower the tension and stress. Tell the participants that they don't need to be afraid. Their fear is not necessary. Emphasize that it's good they are curious. Their desire to learn more is a strength for them. Or something else. Let me know, what would you do in this situation?
I can go first,
Yep, go
if you don't
ahead.
mind. So, actually, I can use a couple of things, and one of them is to attempt to acknowledge individuals' concern and lower the tension, and add other ideas and other ways to trying just to recontrol and be able to deliver the message in the right way. When we're talking about the US laws, like as a beginning, what we can do is just before even showing the video, give a short brief about the topic that we're going to conduct at this time by providing a very brief information that we're going to discuss the laws, the right, your rights and responsibilities in the United States. We're going to show a video that it has some information that might be interesting for you, different than the one that you're experiencing in your home country. And after showing the video, we are going to discuss your concerns, and by collecting all these concerns and ideas and questions that you might have, put them maybe on a whiteboard and bullet points, so can all the participants who shared the same concerns be able to receive the same answer.
Nate
That's impressive.
Mohammed, thank you. Oh, sorry, go ahead, Shaki.
That was very impressive, Mohammed. And give me a second, okay, here we go. Okay. And I want to second that. I think when we are talking to clients, they're already in such a state of stress. So to first bring them back by addressing hey, this sounds like a genuine concern, and I'm sorry you feel that way. Let's go on to then address those concerns. It sounds like this is important for you and you would like to have a more of a conversation. How about we do one thing at a time? And because our clients, especially at our agency, tend to give us so many things at once a lot of times, and it's hard to break them down and then being like, I this is important for me. Your safety is important for me. You coming here and feeling taken care of and acknowledged is vital for me. So let's talk about that a little bit more. So first addressing clients and making sure that they feel valued, then going on to explaining all these laws that is already a hard topic to explain to them.
Perfect. Absolutely. Mohammed, I appreciate as well your idea of giving some pre-session, that information and support at the beginning. And then, like Shaki said, the clients are so stressed. The applicants are so stressed already. We have to very much emphasize one thing at a time, that everything builds and all of the questions seem so important that we need to slow down and not give too much at the same time. Anyone else want to share something in the chat or open your microphone to share?
I think, thank you so much, Nolucha here. I would add to say, before I even start the class, we have made the class rules to say we follow these class rules and this is how we behave ourselves in class. So I think this will be the time for me to also remind that after empathizing, acknowledging the individual concern, to say, please do not forget that we have rules. And maybe before I introduce the topic, I'll also say we are going to talk about this, and then maybe we are going to ask the questions later. And then maybe one person asks a question, and then that question is answered before another person would ask another question again, just to have a control or order of the class. Thank you.
Perfect, Nolucha. Thank you so much for sharing that. I agree, that expectation in advance, especially with a heavy topic like US laws, where everybody feels anxiety, this is the procedure. We will be giving some information, and then one question at a time, we can move forward through this. And these are the standards that we follow. These are the processes that we follow in the classroom. I want to show you the second half of the video, and I would love for you to watch what techniques I, as the fake provider, am trying to use here. What things do I say? What things do I do to try to manage the session? Again, Nolucha, Samir, Silenos, if you can give me a thumbs up to let me know that you could hear the sound, just so that we don't lose the sound.
So I would like to...
Wait, I haven't heard this before. Is the U.S. even safe for me and my family?
Okay, I apologize. I turned off your microphones so that you can hear me clearly. It's very important for me to acknowledge your concerns. The U.S. is a new environment for you, and these changes can be very scary. In the U.S., there are laws that protect everyone from discrimination. That includes refugees and immigrants. The U.S. is a place where everyone has civil rights, and one of those rights is that people can believe what they want. And so you are right that some people do not want immigrants in the United States, but these individuals are not allowed to harm or hurt you because of this belief. You are protected by civil rights, and these same laws and civil rights protect other people. So it is important to understand our rights and responsibilities with US laws. Regan and Ed, your concerns are very important, but our knowledge of US laws and the rights and responsibilities will help us to feel better about these concerns. It's very normal to have questions now and throughout the resettlement process. Please do unmute yourself, and I want you to ask or share any more thoughts or questions, and then we can come back to the topic of our CO session in just a moment.
So what can I do to protect myself and my family? We've often been attacked for our religion, and what do we do if we are attacked? I'm really concerned. What I see on the news does not make it seem like the U.S. is a safe place, but how are we to protect ourselves?
So, Regan, I appreciate that question. There is a lot of information available to us about what life will be like in the U.S., and I hear from you that you have concerns about encounters you may have, especially about religion. Everyone in the United States has a freedom of religion. Some of you also mentioned concerns about discrimination and being treated differently because of your beliefs or because you are a refugee. Remember that people also have freedom of speech in the United States, and that means some people can say or think awful things. but you do have the right to be safe from harm, and you have rights with your landlord, with schools, with your job. The fact that you are all concerned shows that you care about being successful in the United States. And while we can't control the behavior of others, we can learn about the laws in the United States. And the more we know about the laws, the better we are able to balance these challenges and take care of ourselves and our families. So as a refugee, you are responsible to know and follow the law of the United States. In the video that we just watched, they talked about four basic rights. What was another basic right you remembered or you heard them talk about?
Well, I heard someone mention that we have civil rights, but I'm not exactly sure what that means.
Yeah, Ed, so in the United States, you have basic rights that protect you, including civil rights. And civil rights mean the things like freedom of speech, freedom of religion. Civil rights allow people in the U.S. to live freely as they choose, as long as they do not hurt others. This means that people can disagree with you. They can practice different religions, have a different background, have different beliefs, but no one can harm you because of their belief. And that does include refugees and immigrants. How is that different from what you experienced in your home country?
Well, in my country, I wasn't safe and my children couldn't go to school due to our religion. This isn't allowed in the U.S., but I see a lot of Americans harming each other all the time on TV. I'm very concerned that my family won't be safe in the United States.
Too, I can understand that you are afraid about what the United States might hold for you in the future. However, I assure you that if you are harmed for your beliefs, your religion, your opinion, there are legal systems to help you. When you arrive in the U.S., you will have more time to talk about these concerns and learn about the laws of the U.S. with other refugees and your resettlement agency. Your curiosity and your questions are very important, but I might not be able to answer all of your questions today. I do encourage you to continue asking questions and seeking out answers, and I will provide some more resources for you at the end of class to explore on your own.
So I want to ask you to share, share in the chat or share by opening your microphone. So what was something that, the session ends, the CO provider continues to give the session, again, say, emphasizing that the desire to learn is a strength, sharing some links and sharing some resources for information in language, if we can. And then if the provider doesn't have resources, when we don't have something available, we are always wanting to make a note to try to follow up in the future, right? I can reach out to somebody in my agency to find more information. I can refer my client or my applicant to somebody else. I would love for you to share in the chat or share by opening your microphone. What was something that you saw in the video that kept the conversation on topic or helped to comfort or helped to calm down to reduce the stress in the session?
I believe by acknowledging their concerns and their fears about moving to the United States and about the laws, that part makes a huge difference. Then you can discuss it like further by providing the information, providing more details about the civil rights and how the refugee and the immigrants are matters in the United States, and they are protected by laws, and they are not different than other people. However, we identify like in the United States that there is like freedom of religion and their freedom of speech. So each one is, it might be different. We can, and the refugees and immigrants, they have the responsibilities to learn more about that after they arrive in the United States. And in the same time, by the end of the session, maybe we can just refer to them some topics that it might be helpful to better understand the U.S. laws in the United States.
Yeah, absolutely. Sometimes we don't want to, we might think that if we talk about the fear, it makes the fear stronger, but sometimes it can be just the opposite, right? When we say it's okay to feel nervous, it's okay to feel afraid, we actually help to reduce that worry and that fear.
Exactly.
To say, yep, go ahead, Mohammed.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I agree with you.
And it's okay also as the CO provider to say, I don't have an answer for you about that. Maybe we don't know what city the refugee will be going to or what state. Maybe we don't have the knowledge about U.S. law because none of us are lawyers and we don't know everything, especially about this difficult topic. And it is okay for us to say, I don't have an answer for you right now, but I will write that down and I will check with somebody else in my organization. I will do some information gathering and share information when I can find it. Anyone else, what would you say for this session? Another strategy you saw or another thing that you would do if you had this, a similar situation? Oh, Nolucha, I see that in the chat. Yeah, emphasizing that the law is important for everyone, right? The law covers migrants, refugees, asylees, everyone. Even somebody who is undocumented is protected by the U.S. law, right? I might not want to go to the police station as an undocumented person, but I am protected if I get attacked, if I get hurt as an undocumented person, I am protected by the law. Million perfect, the provider put their fears in context, right? Often we have applicants and clients who think that the United States will be this wonderful, perfect place of dreams, right? And the reality is that there are good and bad situations in the United States. There are people who don't want immigrants coming, and it's better for us to acknowledge that and then emphasize that you are still protected by the legal system. You are still protected by equal application of the laws. Other thoughts, something else you would do? We've heard from quite a few of our RSC folks. We've heard from Shaka and Marion domestically. Anyone else domestic who would like to share something or another RSC staff member?
I would say one of the themes that I'm hearing and continuously hear, oh my gosh, I don't know how to, okay. And continuously hear with clients is often like that, yeah, that sense of like, I'm not equal and I'm not like deserving or like, I don't belong. Like it's often a common theme, but I love that you said like, instead of emphasizing that, reminding people like you are in the new space and you like being here is what will make those changes, what will make a difference, like what will continue to raise awareness of like that we are all the same, we are like a part of a world together. So like I do often remind my clients like, I hear you, but like the U.S. does protect immigrants regardless of immigration status, regardless of and it might not seem that way when you're looking at it from the outside, but what can I do to accompany you to feel protected, to feel safe, to feel like you belong? And I think clients appreciate also that honesty from like, you know, I'm a person as well. Like I know what you mean. And I feel that way a lot of times too. So you're not alone in that space, but reminding them of how strong they are, how capable they are, because they've been through so much already, like they said, and like they're in a whole new country learning a million new things. So it's like, you are extremely intelligent already. You're like, you have a set of skills that are needed in this place. So we need you too. Like, not just you, you know, not, it's not the US. We also need you because we have work to do. So it's like, I don't know, makes like, I think that way with my clients a lot.
Shaki, that's wonderful. Like, I cannot tell you how much my heart is happy listening to you explain that and what you're doing to support your clients. We do want to emphasize, right? Everything our clients and applicants have gone through has been difficult and makes them stronger. It's hard to see those difficult things as a strength, but it is a strength. And being able to navigate all of the procedure and system, the airport for the first time, all the documentation that they're going through, all of those things are so difficult that emphasizing the skills it takes to be in a new country, is very important. We have just a few more minutes before we will go back to the main room. So anybody who has not spoken yet or shared yet in the chat, would you like to share anything else about strategies you use, things that you do with clients to bring back the focus? I have a few slides to share before we close out, but I want to also give space for any more of your knowledge. Go ahead, Masood.
Good morning, everyone. How are you all? Sorry I joined late because I had to do something else. But in order to give a strength and a strategy that I'm using for our clients, or because I came as IV, actually, when I came on that time in 2006 in Richmond, Virginia, it was not even SIV. It was a general letter. A general letter, it means that one of the U.S. Army general letter, because I was linguist with U.S. Army myself, and they give you a letter. Once you get your clearance, you could come. But everything took 6 months, so I moved to the U.S. So when I came to the Richmond, obviously that I was culture shocked. I was like, oh my God, what's going on? Why I pay monthly rent? This is stuff because I never paid rent in my life. But anyway, I got a couple of families from my wife's side because they helped us. They co-signed us an apartment and they took our hand and stand our feet. But I always give example of myself to our clients and say, hey, don't worry about it. One day I was in your shoes. The thing is, you know, you're lucky that resettlement agency helping you, give you welcome money. We are like a team working at the CCC here. I work as a school caseworker also. I help your children go to school. But when I came on that time, there was no help, like a zero. I went to the social service. I got 8 months Medicaid and a couple of months TANF and maybe 6 months food stamp, but that's it. But I always give them an example that, hey, work hard, because we came from out of United States, and I don't know how many minutes we have. I'm sorry, can you remind me how many minutes we have? I don't want to take too much time.
We just have maybe 2 more minutes in our
week. Okay, that's fine. I just wrap it up. The thing is this, we all don't have a family here, but we all have family here. And no matter, don't worry about it if your family's back home, but you know, I'm here. I'm not here only to do the intake or help your children go to school, but I'm here to share from my experience. 17 years I've been in US, and I can share that one for you. That gave a strong strength and encouragement to our clients that say, hey, this is another country for us. And people ask me, where are you from? I'm like, I'm from Virginia. I don't say I'm from Afghanistan. Then no, originally, this is the country, you know, I pay tax here. I live here. My kids go to school. That's my country. United States built by immigrants. But anyway, that was all. Thank you so much, everyone.
Masood, I appreciate very much the emphasis that we are all in this together. I have not worked as a direct service CO provider, but I worked for over 10 years with refugees in a resettlement agency. And I would talk about how I don't have the experience of moving to a new country, but my family came during famine in Norway and Sweden when the fields failed. My family came, you know, 100 years ago as refugees who had no food, right? They left the country because there was no food available for the family at that time. So emphasizing that we are all in this together, having coworkers who have been through those experiences, it really does help to offer that comfort. Licia, I apologize if I'm pronouncing wrong. Licia, how do you address the fear of political changes? I think this is very similar to every fear and anxiety. Again, saying that we are here together. When Donald Trump became president, I was working in a resettlement office, and that was a very difficult time because there was a lot of change in how many refugees would be accepted, how many refugees would be admitted to the United States. And being there to say that we are here for you, we will help you to navigate this. It's the best that we can do because we can't control who is in Congress, or we can't change the president out just because we don't like them. Does anybody else have a moment of to share with Licia about fear of political change before we jump back into our other room? Before I close out here, I want to just really do a quick share of these are some of the strategies that we just talked about actually all throughout this conversation. We want to manage those expectations and talk about what support clients and applicants will receive throughout the process. We want to be de-escalating, like bringing people back down, calming things down with acknowledging the stress and talking through it. Again, acknowledging those concerns, sharing information when we have the information, and being able to say, I don't have all the answers as well. And then emphasizing always that curiosity is a strength. Our clients are so much stronger than they think they are. And it's good for us to emphasize that strength for them. I wish that we had 5 hours to talk together and continue sharing. Really, really, I appreciate everybody who opened their microphone and shared in the chat as well. Nalucha, Masood, Mohammed, Shaki, thank you so much, Marian. We are going to be jumping back to the main room now. And so it's just really been wonderful to talk with you, to share with you. And then we will come back together as a whole group in that main room.
Welcome, welcome, folks. Thank you, Amy, for closing the rooms. My room was talkative too, and so I kind of let it go on a little bit longer than what we said. So we are going to share all the great takeaways out here in just a moment. But I do know that coming back from breakout rooms at times can be a little jarring. You might have been in a mid-sentence or what have you, but I hope you got some good conversations in your breakouts. Yeah. Okay, some nods. Let me go ahead and get my screen share ready for our debrief here. So this is what we're going to do for our debrief in the last little bit that we have together is that each facilitator is going to debrief on 3 techniques discussed in their breakout room to address common challenges with law. And then we want you, as the facilitator is debriefing, if you have any other takeaways or thoughts, you can go ahead and share those thoughts from your notes in the chat with everybody. So I was actually the facilitator for the first breakout room. So I'm going to go ahead and share some of the techniques that we talked about. So in the first breakout room, we had staying on topic. about to say the other one. It's been a long week. So we had the staying on topic, which is how do we manage a CO session when there's a lot of concerns and anxiety and fear and a lot of questions that take us off the COO and I. And to be honest, my group had already down kind of the technique in mind. They kind of knew what those techniques were, including making sure that you validate the concerns and fears that clients have and really ground them in what's real and what's within their control versus what might be outside of their control or what they're hearing in the news. So letting them know that, yes, there are things that may happen in the U.S., but there are laws and rights that you have and steps that you can take to ensure that to handle those situations. And so making sure we don't really sugarcoat what life in the U.S. is really going to be like. But one of my big takeaways in my room was that there were a lot of techniques that my group was able to identify. And so what that really leads me to say, or my takeaway is that a lot of you do know how to keep your sessions on topic, but that what you might be struggling with is your own personal boundaries as to what you should know and what other folks should know. And so I really wanna, my takeaway for everyone on this call is to give yourself some credit. Remind yourself that you are not the only individual in this process that the client, refugee, or applicant is going to interact with, and that you do not need to know all of the information about every U.S. law. You're not an immigration expert. You're not a public assistance expert. And to really alleviate yourself of the pressure to have the answers to everything, and to remember that part of CO is to get clients and refugees and applicants to take control of their own learning and to advocate for themselves in the process. So that's my big takeaway. If anybody else from group one has any other thoughts that they feel like I didn't cover, go ahead and share that in the chat. And we'll take a look at those and read those after Amy debriefs with breakout room two.
I was four, so who was?
Sorry, Stephanie.
That's okay, Stephanie's got breakout room two, okay.
Yes, I am. Well, thank you everybody for participating in the breakout room. I really learned a lot from all the participants that were over there. We were talking about how to address or expectations about U.S. laws. And one of the techniques that we discussed when managing U.S. laws was to ensure that they know the consequences of breaking the law. So And it is not an excuse not to know about the law because they will have consequences. So that's one of the things that we explain over there. And we had a scenario over there. It was about the driving license in the United States. And one of the things that we discuss is that it's important to know the laws, to have an exam and all of that. So you can explain that, but also it's, you have to focus on the objectives and indicators. And one of the objectives and indicators says that you have consequences of breaking the law. So maybe this topic, it is not essential. It's not one of the things that you will do as soon as you arrive to the United States to get your driver's license. But you can use their curiosity to tell them to find out the answer by themselves, to empower them, and to explain that they have also the opportunity to find this information by themselves. And also we were talking about very difficult conversations like domestic violence. Good answers were brought how to address this. And one of the things that we said that is important to know your objectives and indicators, no matter if you are overseas or if you are domestic. I don't know if someone else have any other point from my breakout room.
Thank you so much, Stephanie. If you're from breakout room two and you have any other points, you can go ahead and put that in the chat and we can share that out after we hear from two and Dennis here. I don't see anybody sharing from group one in the chat. So I think it sounds like I covered everything. But if you do have any thoughts, go ahead and let us know. But over to Dennis to debrief on group three.
Hi, everyone. I'm going to share our debrief. Dennis was our breakout room facilitator. He did such a great job. And the participants in the room just shared so many great insights. Really made me think and helped me learn. So I'll try my best to share some of the approaches that rose up from the responses. And I invite folks to join in the chat if you want to expand on it. I think that the things that came out of, you know, we did talk about specific things that we would say, but I think that the thing that really stood out was like the approach that people would take. And so a couple of things I noticed was we talked about having empathy, recognizing that when people have fears or misinformation that they're worried about that where that's coming from. And then they're not wrong, but to see where they're, but we, they're not completely, they would help them see a bigger picture. We talked about emphasizing the rule of law in the U.S. that even if they're not citizens yet, they have rights and responsibilities in the United States, and there are protections for them, and they have they shouldn't be treated differently. We talked about being mindful of having positive assumptions about newcomers, and that they believe they are here because they want to follow the rules. They want to be safe and protected and know the rules and laws that they have to follow, but also having some positive assumptions about the law enforcement in the area, that the police is there as a bigger role to protect people. Sometimes things go wrong, but they not have fear about interacting with police, because sometimes their interactions with police can be positive and they need the police to report crime. And other times if there's a fear of negative interactions, that there are rules and responsibilities and techniques that they could use, and that they have rights in those process. And the last thing that came up is like, this is a very complicated topic, and that we have to build, that our newcomers have build their own agency. So equipping them with knowledge of information, with resources and procedures, so that they can make the best decisions in their interactions with the police. So jump in group three if there's more that you'd like to add. It was a very deep discussion.
It sounds like it was a deep discussion. So I don't see any comments from group two, but if you were in group three and you have anything else to share, we can go back to that after Amy shares for group four.
Yeah, just like Ella, Stephanie, and Chu all said, our group four was very talkative and had a lot of great insights to share. We were focused on the changes in family dynamics that happen connected to the U.S. law, the change in hierarchy, gender equality, family violence, child discipline, and safety. And we talked about, as one of our major strategies, really validating the client or applicant's feelings. It's okay that you are struggling with this as the client. It is different from the culture to culture, and it's okay to feel frustrated with that. One of our participants in our room talked about her father. When she was an immigrant, her father struggled with the change in dynamics. And I said, that's a great thing to share to your clients, to say, like, many people feel this way. It's okay that you're feeling that way, and that validation and empathy, just like Tu was saying as well. We had a great comment about, or a great takeaway about, maybe asking the client or the applicant for more. Why are you feeling this way? Why do you think that you will lose some rights? Why do you think that you are going to struggle with this? And maybe we can dig into that deeper and find if it's misunderstandings or misconceptions, or if it's truly an issue. One of my participants was spot on by saying what she does is she says, this is the law. Cultural differences are cultural differences, but this is the law of the United States. You must follow this law or there are consequences. Coming back to that rule of law and that situation where you can disagree with this, you can disagree with the gender equality or the idea of child supervision and what age and all of these different things, but this is the law and you must follow the law. And I truly thought that was a great way to kind of ground ourselves, especially when we had a comment about consent for sexual relations inside of a relationship, a husband and wife. Why do I need to get consent from my wife? This is the law, right? I am not going to talk about cultural versus culture, but this is the law of the United States. I'm going to pass it back over to Ella, and if anybody else in group four, Aisha, I love that. Don't sugarcoat. And just to be honest, I love that very much.
Great. Thank you so much. And sorry to cut you off, Amy, just realizing we have about 30 seconds left and we need to wrap up. So I'm going to go ahead and ask Amy to put the post survey in the chat. So if those of you who need to leave on time can go ahead and just pop over and complete that chat as we're wrapping up here. But one of the themes that I'm hearing in everyone's takeaways is that we're always coming back to the cultural orientation, objectives, and indicators, right? That we're always coming back to those messaging, and it really tells you, and it really reinforces that the role that those indicators play and those objectives play in the process. So I do see a very, very long thing in the chat, Abdul, and I promise I will come to this. Let me go ahead and wrap this up, and then I'll loop back to that comment. So here are some strategies to manage common challenges with U.S. laws. As you probably heard from all of us, you heard similar themes, right? And that a lot of the strategies that we heard in each of our group can apply to each of those situations. So we've kind of compiled some of those strategies here on the screen. We're gonna update this when we send out the PowerPoint with more strategies that we heard from you today, but we really just wanted to validate that you guys have a lot of these strategies. And it's just, again, continuing to build your confidence and skills. We also are gonna be sending you in our resources, some our follow-up materials, additional resources for U.S. laws, and we split it up by individuals working in resettlement and newcomer-facing resources, because we know that there's more English resources available and that they always go meet newcomer needs. So we're going to be sending out a resource to you that has what we think are reliable sources on U.S. laws. Again, we're not expecting you, if you're overseas or domestic, to know all of this information. This is just to help you build up your confidence and to get some good resources on U.S. laws. And then just again, wrapping up, that we have a survey that we would like you to complete. We'll also send it out via email. It'll take you 5 minutes and give us just feedback on this webinar and let us know what your needs are. We also encourage you to subscribe to the Core Connection newsletter. So I know that we're at time, and I am going to get to your question here, Abdul, and I'll read that. So if you are able to stay with us, please feel free to stay. Otherwise, you're welcome to go.